Well, it's finally here, a mini PC that has the option to plug in a dedicated GPU. After all, you probably know from the mini PCs that I do review in the channel, they all run on integrated graphics, and they normally all have very weak integrated graphics. It's always the bottleneck of these systems, but you can completely bypass that now and turn it into, well, a desktop powered mini PC almost, because it's got desktop parts here now, but in a smaller form factor, very similar to the NUC Extreme Core i9 I have here from Intel. Now, this configuration of the Mini's Forum B550 that was sent out to me to review has 16 gigabytes of RAM, 512 gigabytes of storage, and the Ryzen 7 5700G. It costs $729. You can buy it as a bare bones for $600. Compare that to a 12th gen Intel NUC Extreme here, which cost €1,600 bare bones. Big difference, similar size, and the same GPU performance, because this can also handle two slot dedicated GPUs within it. The B550 comes in this travel pouch. It's fabric around, it's got a zip around it and a carry handle there at the top, as you can see. So when you open it up, we've got a space at the top here for our power supply, and I'll show you that shortly. And you'll see here that we do have a bit of an instruction manual in various different languages that just goes over everything. There is this warning card here, and it's just telling us that we should not connect up an ATX power supply and also their power supply to the mini PC for a risk there of short-circuiting something. So it could damage it, so make sure you don't do that. So there's a little layer here to protect the mini PC that is strapped into place there. In the top pouch, I have the power cable here. So it's just an ATX style power plug that goes into our power adapter. Now this one's rated to a maximum output of just shy of 120 watts. Then the base here for the external GPUs, right, that you'd be running with PCIe slots. So you've got PCIe slots right there. There are some holes where you're going to be screwing in the mount for it to support the weight of the graphics card. We have this right here, which is ATX power on the side of it. Now, Mini's Forum have advised me they're going to be making some changes to this to widen up the space around this plug, because a lot of people have been having difficulty actually plugging in the ATX power to this. So they will make a change to that, and that's going to be coming in about a month's time or so for the final retail versions. What I've got is basically, you could say, a pre-release prototype of this. Now, what else do we get? So there's the brace for it. We do have some other parts there for the GPU, for the support. We've got our ATX power cable. So they have their own ones here that are a little bit shorter in white. And you'll see that there are just a few other bits and pieces there to do with the support of it. An HDMI card too is included. And then we do get a lot of screws and other bits and pieces for that dock there for the external PCIe GPU. All of the ports of this mini PC are located just on this one side, but we do get quite a lot, as you can see. Power button, Kensington lock slot, power in if you're going to be just using this mini PC by itself, so not an external graphics card. DisplayPort 1.4a, HDMI 2.0, so that's 4K 60 from all three of those. We can run three monitors at 4K 60. USB Type A, this is USB 3.2 Gen 1, so we've got four Type A ports in total. And then one Type-C right here, separate audio jack, so audio in and mic and audio out there too, and 2.5 gigabit LAN. On side here, we've got a big vent and a tiny little button in there. You need a paperclip for it, of course, for our reset BIOS button. And then powered by AMD here, so that is made out of an alloy. It's painted. The build quality is very good, actually, of this mini PC. And then this side here, we've got a little cover that you need to unscrew and remove if you're going to be using that graphics dock there. Well, the base for it, for the PCIe graphics card. So that's where the interface is for it, and another vent there. Along the top, we've got a huge vent, and you can see the fan within there. So it's a very large fan and all the cooling fins below that. And I'll report, of course, on the thermals and the fan noise later on in this in-depth review. And then we have the back of it. So there are four screws to remove if you want to gain access to the internals, which of course you need to do if you buy the bare bones version. And you'll see we've got these little rubber flaps that are covering and protecting the power ports here if you're going to be using, again, that dock. So we've got a 10-pin connector right here, and then the 4-pin CPU connector. And it does have these warnings there, again, not to be running their power supply, so connected up with that DC
plug, the round one, and then the PCU plugs, you don't want that connected at the same time, both of them, or you will damage it. And there are the two mounting points right there for VESA mounting this. So yes, it can actually go on the back of a monitor or a TV. And our internals here and possible upgrades. So very easy to get into this. You just loosen off those four screws on the backing plate. It comes right off, no issues at all. Now we've got our wireless card, which is a Realtek one here. It's Wi-Fi AX with Bluetooth 5. You can change, swap and upgrade that. Not a problem. Our SSD, now this is a PCIe 3.0 SSD, but depending on the chipset you do have in this, it will actually support one of these M.2 slots PCIe 4-spec drives, which is great. Now my version here, as I mentioned at the start, does have the Ryzen. It's the 5700G in this, which is a powerful unit, of course, with its 8 cores, 16 threads. We've got this right here, which is our SATA 3 2.5-inch bay. If you wanted to add a slower drive, you can do that. But there is right here another additional M.2. So this will support SATA 3 SSDs and also PCIe 3.0. So we can only run one PCIe 4 if the chipset supports it, and then PCIe 3.0, of course, because we've got the PCIe slot here. So that, I've taken the cover off it now, is where you slot in the dock, which I'll show you. So that is where it's going to go here, okay? That's going to slot into place. You push it in. It's clipped in now, and then we can slot in a GPU. And here we have the internals of it. So you can see we've got a huge cooler here with a nice big fan on the top of it. Fan noise so far in my testing has been excellent, really good. Quite low when it's definitely not doing anything. You barely even hear it at all. It's almost silent. But I'll report on those thermals later on after really pushing this, of course, very hard. So you can see we've got two SODIMM slots there, the upright style there. So it is easy enough to upgrade the RAM, although getting to this RAM means you need to pull out this whole motherboard, which is a little tricky. Make sure you unplug first the wireless antenna connectors, and there is a plug that's in this here. It's a little cable that I think goes to a power plug or something else. It goes to the LEDs on the top of it. So you need to remove that, otherwise you could damage something. The ATX power supply that I'm using for this is a Corsair RM750, so 750 watts, plenty of power here. To power that RTX that I have, the 3080 Ti, which is an ASUS Tough Gaming. Now the card does fit in quite nice there, and the mini PC slotted in, got all the cables plugged into it. However, the power supply is a bit of an afterthought really, because it has no base that it screws into. It doesn't screw into anything. So it's kind of just floating around there a little bit. And I've got it sitting on the side here, which is blocking a little bit the intake fan. But this power supply from Corsair, most of the time the fan's not actually on, so it's not really going to be a problem. And of course, all being open here, an exposed build, really, you've got plenty of cooling then for all of this. You don't even need a fan blowing on this. And the Tough Gamer, most of the time the fans are off, unless pushed really hard, just like that power supply. So from behind, you can see that it's open right here for the cooling for that mini PC, for the B550, and the power supply back of it is a little ugly. Cable management could be a bit better here, but what I've done is just try to tie it and get it out of the way so you don't really see it that much. It's still a lot tidier than having an external GPU hooked up to a power supply on one of those brackets that I do use in other videos. From the top, it doesn't look too bad here. Now, I used my own PCIe cables and other cables from the power supply, which is modular. It just worked out to be a little bit easier like that. Now, it really depends on your budget. I know the build that I've got here is high-end, right? The RTX 3080 Ti. You could go with something like older cards, not a problem. Any external GPU is going to be able to work in this. Just like the other mini PCs I've reviewed from Mini's Forum, it does have a completely unlocked BIOS. So you're able to go in here and mess about with so many different settings, the power configuration, you even got RAM disk configuration, AMD overclocking menu, you can go into this to tweak the RAM timings, overclocking the CPU, you get the idea. It is all in there, which is really good to see. Do be careful, however, because if you mess up any of the RAM timing settings, it won't boot. You'll absolutely just brick that BIOS. Well, it just won't boot and you have to go and reset it using that little button, that little hole on the side of the mini PC. That's why it's there. My model here is configured with the Ryzen 7, the 5700G. It's an 8-core chip with 16 threads, and it does max out the turbo at 4.6 gigahertz. It is unlocked, so you can tweak around and overclock it. I won't be covering that in this video, but if the video does well, it has a lot of interest, I will possibly look into overclocking it and just how much I can, how far I can push the chipset. 65 watt part, and it's the AM4 platform, which they're going to be using for the Ryzen 6000 series. So hopefully we should be able to upgrade too, considering it's a desktop chip. You can easily remove that if you wanted to. So it does come with Windows 10 Pro, and you can upgrade to Windows 11 Pro. Not a problem, very easy to do. In fact, on first boot, on the setup with Windows 10 Pro, and you're connected to the internet, if you are, it will ask you if you want to upgrade on the spot there. It's a 4 gigabyte download. So my configuration has 16 gigabytes of RAM. It's in dual channel, of course, DDR4, 3200 megahertz, and then a 512 gigabyte SSD from Kingston. The RAM's also Kingston brand. So these SSD speeds, you can see now that they're okay, but not the fastest that you can get from PCIe 3.0 spec. For a last gen chip, because we do have the Ryzen 6000 series coming, it does perform really well, as you see. The single core scores here, good, but they won't match the new Alder Lake from Intel, and the multi-core score there is good as well. So that Intel NUC that I showed you before that I'm also testing out and possibly might review too, you can see what kind of scores that gets. I'll just briefly show you this, just to see the difference between 12th gen, the next gen, of course, and then the previous AMD. You can see there's a huge gap there, okay? So I do hope that Minis Forum do decide to bring out an Alder Lake version of this with the external GPU dock would be really good. As far as GPU performance goes, I'm not seeing any difference here at all compared to my desktop that I have, which is a Ryzen 9 5950X. It's very, very similar here. So graphics scores getting in around 19,000 points for Time Spy are excellent. Now running off the integrated graphics, which is the Vega 8, which I will not be focusing on in this video, you only get a score for graphics of about just over 1,200 points, all right? So I'm not even gonna focus on it because it's the integrated graphics. This is all about the external GPU, really, this model, the reason to get it. So here is Firestrike here Ultra. You can see it gets a really good score. That's running in 4K, and again, that GPU, the RTX 3080 Ti, is not being bottlenecked here really at all. Now with an Intel system, I can actually get slightly higher scores here because of the higher single core speeds that it does have in performance. And Firestrike, again, just a super good rock solid score here. This shows that this mini PC is an absolute gaming monster. It is a beast. The only thing that's holding it back really is the physics score, the CPU, which is still very good, 8 cores, 16 threads, which does give us impressive multi-core performance here for Cinebench R23 for a 8-core APU. That's very powerful still, even in 2022, and considering the fact that look at how small this mini PC is, the small form factor of it, even with the GPU, still small and doesn't really make a lot of noise at all. So that's great performance there. Now, video playback with the RTX 3080 Ti handling this, as you can imagine, it's fine to handle 4K HEVC files, not an issue at 140 megabits per second. Cyberpunk, or should I say cyber glitch? What just happened then? There was a guy inside the motorbike for a second. Wow. It's still glitchy even on the latest patch. So I'm running here the full settings, highest settings, should I say, apart from ray tracing at 4K. So ray tracing I do have set to the medium preset, and the performance is pretty much almost the same as my slightly more powerful desktop, which I'm running a Ryzen 9 5950X in. It's just a few frames per second on average slower. So I'm getting about 50 frames per second here, and on my desktop, it would be maybe about 52, 53 frames per second. There's really not much difference in it at all, and amazing considering how small this mini PC is. Now, of course, it's all gonna be dependent on what graphics card you use, so if you decide to go with a more lower end or older card, it's all gonna be dependent on that, of course. Grand Theft Auto now with the absolute maximum settings at 4K. It's getting a pretty good frame rate here of almost close to 90 frames per second. This is outside of the car, and I think
the frame rate. It could be tweaked a little bit, of course, if I decided to lower down some of those settings there, because I do run a 4K 120 Hz monitor. I myself would probably lower a couple of things so I can get it at a steady 120. But decent performance here, and again, that Ryzen 7, the 5700G, is not slowing down really or bottlenecking by much. It's just a tiny little fraction the performance of this RTX 3080 Ti. What about our fan noise and our thermals and power consumption? So power consumption, I see just the mini PC itself pulling about 106 watts peak. That's stressing it out with benchmarks. And idle, it is around about 12 watts. That's with a few things plugged into it. And you'll see here that those thermals are just fantastic. This mini PC barely makes any noise. The fan noise is so good. It's just a whooshing noise and you barely even really hear it. It's so much better than my Intel NUC, which is loud. It can get quite loud, that one there. But you can see, over 70 degrees, that's it. That's just fantastic when it comes to the thermal performance here. So the cooler is capable of handling, I believe, higher wattage and higher clocks. 4K video editing and export times now. So the timeline here, really good. Why is it so fast? Why is it not really lagging at all, dropping any frames, and feels just as good as my desktop? That's because the CUDA cores from that RTX 3080 Ti are handling this, not the Vega 8 graphics. If I was using the Vega 8 graphics right now, there would be a bit of lag here, and it certainly wouldn't handle the full playback resolution that I'm currently using for the preview without dropping any frames. That's all smooth. So excellent performance for things like this. For 4K video editing, it's not an issue, and I don't really see that Ryzen 7, the 5700G, holding things up. The export preset that I'm using here is the 4K YouTube preset. So start on my timer and export, which is a 2 second delay or so. This should not take long at all because we've got an RTX 3080 Ti in this. Oh, that's incredibly quick. Looking very good. It doesn't have the benefit of that Intel quick sync, so not actually quite as fast as I thought for 1 minute of footage, but it does look like it is going to finish in about, there we go, safe to say approximately 25 seconds for 1 minute of footage. That's really quick. Lastly, Linux support. So I ran into an issue with the MediaTek drivers for that RZ608 wireless chipset with its Bluetooth. Nothing, okay? So I have to use the LAN port on there to be able to download drivers or connect up to the internet. So that's one little obstacle you need to get around if you do intend to run Linux off of this particular mini PC.
Now then, I wanted to do a very quick comparison. This is the Intel NUC Extreme Core i9. It retails here in Europe for 1600 euros. Bare bones means there's no SSD, there's no RAM, there's no operating system. This bare bones is around approximately just under 600 euros. So that's a massive difference in the pricing. It takes an external GPU. This takes an external GPU up to 2.5 slot. This is a 2.5 slot card. This will only take two slot GPUs that will fit into it. So you can have something that gives you similar gaming performance for a lot yet less. Now, of course, it's not perfect. I know a lot of people in the comments are probably going to mention that, hey, you just sacrificed on the point of this being small form factor, mini PC, nice and small on your desk. Now it's a big beast. Of course, it depends on what you want. It's optional, the GPU, it's optional what GPU model you use. Now the power supply, this is my criticism, floats around here. The power supply 4-pin CPU connector, at least with my Corsair modular power supply, did not want to be plugged in. I had a blue light on the front, status LED, and it wouldn't power up. But when I removed that cable and just used the pin at the top, the connector ATX power to it, it worked fine then and didn't have an issue. There's no shroud over this, there's no case, okay? So it's all exposed, dust's gonna get on top of the graphics card, it doesn't look pretty, but the cooling's really good. Now, because I have fan stop on the GPU and basic fan stop on the PSU, I don't really hear any noise from this mini PC. So they've done an excellent job. Mini's forum with their cooling is a lot better than B-Link mini PCs. It barely makes any noise. You can hardly hear the fan. The thermals are excellent. And of course you could probably definitely increase power limits and even try a little bit of overclocking and RAM timing tweaks
with it to squeeze out even more performance. So I think this is a great mini PC. You can turn it into an absolute gaming monster. It's really good, but it's not for everyone. It's not perfect. Thank you so much for watching my review here of Minis Forum, the B550.